Hello, my name is Julia Prendergast and I'm a senior lecturer in writing at Swinburne University in Melbourne. In my personal practice, I write short and long form fiction, and increasingly I write short fiction, sudden fiction, as I like to call it, following Thomas and Shepard, who have done some beautiful collections about sudden fiction. And then people have written to me and called my works of sudden fiction prose poetry. So nevertheless, I call myself a fiction writer. And so in thinking about this question of why does fiction matter, I am completely biased. I think storytelling matters enormously. It matters enormously to me personally, obviously, but I think it matters to us as human beings, regardless of whether we are writers in any traditional sense. So where to begin with this question? Gordon Weaver talks about felt presences in poetry, actually, but I think it's true of fiction and other writing too. And I love this idea of felt presences, and I've talked to students about it because I'm super interested in the way in which my own writing, my own invented characters, as well as the work of other writers that moves me, is capable, I think, of entering our affect cycle. And I think that's magic. I mean, how this magic, I suppose, and I think that magic is related to this idea of felt presences, because if we think about writing in very literal terms, we're talking about letters and words and sentences on a page. So how is it actually possible that words on a page can move us, can enter our own affect cycle as if they were lived experience? This is something that I have thought and think about a lot. So I'm going to try to give some kind of practical examples from my writing and teaching practice to show what I mean here. So when back in the day, when I was an undergraduate student at Monash Uni in Melbourne, and I was in one of the very upper floors of the Menzies building, and I was a unit called Contemporary Women's Fiction and Theory, and it was an extraordinary unit and it affected my thinking and writing in so many ways and still does. And I was in a class once and we were looking at poetry that week, one poem in particular, and I was over emotionally overwhelmed. I lost it. I started crying and excused myself from the tutorial to collect myself. And I talk to students about this example a lot because I didn't understand the poem. And so I thought I've thought about my emotional response, my overwhelming emotional response in that case to something that I didn't logically understand. And so when I talk to students about that moment, it's in relation to poetry and fiction. And I say to them, don't worry if you don't get it. Interrogate how it makes you feel. Get to the bottom of that as a starting point, and copy sentences and collect sentences that move you and keep going back and interrogating why they make you feel the way they do. So when I think about that moment in that poem, it was actually a lesbian love poem. And this was a couple of days after Mother's Day, and my beautiful mum had just died at the age of 43. And I had this new baby girl who was 8 weeks old. So of course, it makes me want to cry now, because of course I did understand the poem, because I did understand love between women. That's what the poem was about. So this is the example I give to students in the sense of saying, don't fret about academic, theoretical, textual analysis as a starting point. Think about feeling thinking as it relates to words. So this is why I think fiction matters, because fiction is about interrogating lens, point of view, voice as a way of feeling thinking. And I think I know that fiction expands my empathic compass in writing fiction, in thinking about registers of intelligence that are not my own, focalizing consciousnesses that are not my own. And then I think about how that moment back in the day as an undergraduate has kind of informed my thinking as I go along, and I try to, wherever possible, take my evolving ideas about fiction and poetry and creative nonfiction and other narrative forms, my practice to my teaching. And so I think anything that I anything that I feel that I've written that may be worthwhile is always born from this idea, the idea in my mind of the incompleteness of human experience. And what I mean there is conundrum and contradiction at the level of idea, something I don't understand, or something that I understand emotionally but I'm troubled by, or something I've witnessed that I want to understand more fully. And all of my fiction writing and other writing arises from those moments of wanting to understand better. So fiction writing as a way of problem solving. And so in recognizing that, I then began to do workshops with students, undergrad students, and workshops in industry. And I ask participants in those workshops to begin from these moments, to take an autobiographical memory, something that is an incident that is unresolved in their mind. And it doesn't have to be something, you know, enormous or traumatic or troubling. It can just be a half-heard conversation that they have thought about since and that they have wanted to understand better. And I have students write from that moment, and then we work with alternate points of view, different registers of intelligence as a way to building fiction. So I think that's an example of the way that I've taken my own practice to teaching, but more fully this has informed my more traditional research, where I'm super fascinated by metacognition and the impact of this kind of thinking, which fiction demands of us, engaging with other ways of seeing and knowing, as a way of expanding our empathic compass. So I guess the beginning of the research that I've done post PhD is best explained by an example again, and that I had an email once from a neuroscientist who's based in Frankfurt. And the neuroscientist's name is Danko Nikolic, and he wrote to me and he said, "I hope you're the right Julia. I just read your story, like clay, and it moved me very much, almost made me cry. Is it yours?" And I was overwhelmed, and I burst out crying, because at the very time that this neuroscientist wrote to me about creative work, I was reading into his theory of ideesthesia, which literally translates as sensing concepts. And I thought, what are the chances of that? Practitioners from totally different fields of practice, opposite sides of the world, connecting through felt presences. If I go back to where I was before, he was responding to felt presences in my writing. But actually this theory of ideesthesia, which I argue is what writers do, they sense concepts and they translate concepts into sensory data in order to create a story. So this has become like the basis of all of my more traditional research into this area, what is the impact on writers' brains. But more broadly, I think about, if we're asking this question of why does fiction matter, what are the broader ramifications in the health sphere for those who have whose empathic pathways are blocked, and in everyday terms, people suffering from anxiety and depression, which is in epidemic proportions in young people, right? They can't imagine other ways of being or seeing. So I've thought about those kind of things a lot, and then to try to feed those into projects like the Incompleteness book, which I co-edited recently with two very dear colleagues, Shane Strange and Jen Webb, where we had authors write back to this idea of the incompleteness of human experience in the context of the pandemic. And then I've taken all of that work together with artist statements about what they were writing about to students, and had students do this work. So it's been enormously enriching for me personally, and I think as an exchange between writers. And this, another thing I love about art, is this process of art generating art when we engage in these projects together. And then I think in more traditional terms, in terms of my research, I have a partnership with the neuroscience neuroimaging department at my university for a project called Ideaesthetic Imagining, Mapping the Brain's Microstates Using Magnetoencephalography. So what we're going to do in that project is for me to run like this incompleteness writing workshop while participants our brains are being mapped using MEG. So I think the organic reason that fiction matters to me is because it is a conveyance of felt presences from person to person. And I think I have tried to kind of weave that through. When I was offered this job, a beautiful professor at the university I'd studied at and done my PhD at said to me, "Don't you ever forget why you got that job, Julia, because you're a writer." So I think that has been very informative to me. I hear her voice all the time, especially with, you know, the attack on the arts in recent times, and I guess in general, and thinking about, you know, what matters to me, why does fiction matter, thinking about that organically and then taking that more broadly into thinking about that in terms of brain and mind, and in terms of teaching and giving back to students in the way that I was in the way that I was informed by teachers who gave to me. I dedicate this acknowledgement to country to a dear friend, Paul Collis, an Indigenous writer, and to a friendship built on what Paul, honouring Franz Fanon in black skin, white mask, calls listening fiercely, and to what I call acute listening. We're speaking the same language, of course. I pay homage to Australia's original storytellers who remind us that storytelling is about acute listening. I express my deep gratitude to Aboriginal community elders, past, in perpetuity, present and emerging. Terra nullius, what a fraud. I'm deeply sorry for the damage our shameful history has inflicted upon Australia's original custodians. I live and work on what is and always was Aboriginal land. In my case, the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation.